This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Anglo-Norman, also known as Anglo-Norman French, is a variety of the langues doïl that was used in England and, to a lesser extent, elsewhere in the British Isles during the Anglo-Norman period when William the Conqueror led the Norman invasion of England in 1066. He, his nobles, and many of his followers from Normandy, but also those from northern and western France, spoke a range of oïl dialects, northern French dialects. One of these was Norman. Other followers spoke varieties of the Picard language or western French. This amalgam developed into the unique insular dialect now known as Anglo-Norman French, which was commonly used for literary and eventually administrative purposes from the 12th until the 15th century. It is difficult to know much about what was actually spoken, as what is known about the dialect is restricted to what was written, but it is clear that Anglo-Norman was to a large extent the spoken language of the higher social strata in medieval England. It was spoken in the law courts, schools, and universities and, in due course, in at least some sections of the gentry and the growing bourgeoisie. Private and commercial correspondence was carried out in Anglo-Norman or Anglo-French from the 13th to the 15th century, though its spelling forms were often displaced by continental spellings. Social classes other than the nobility became keen to learn French. Manuscripts containing materials for instructing non-native speakers still exist, dating mostly from the late 14th century onwards. Although Anglo-Norman and Anglo-French were eventually eclipsed by modern English, they had been used widely enough to influence English vocabulary permanently. Thus, many original Germanic words, cognates of which can still be found in Nordic, German and Dutch, have been lost or, as more often occurs, they exist alongside synonyms of Anglo-Norman French origin. Grammatically, Anglo-Norman had little lasting impact on English, although it is still evident in official and legal terms where the ordinary sequence of noun and adjective is reversed. For example, attorney general, the spelling is English but the word order noun then adjective is French. Other such examples are heir apparent, court martial, and body politic. The royal coat of arms of the United Kingdom still features in French the mottos of both the British monarch, Dieu et mon droit, God and my right, and the order of the garter, Honi soit qui mal y pense, shamed be he who thinks evil of it. Dieu et mon droit was first used by Richard I in 1198 and adopted as the royal motto of England in the time of Henry VI. The motto appears below the shield of the royal coat of arms. Contents 1. Use and development 2. Trilingualism in medieval England 21. Language of the king and his court 22. Language of the royal charters and legislation 23. Language of administration and justice 231. In the royal and local courts 24. Language of the people 3. Characteristics 4. Literature 5. Influence of Anglo-Norman French on English 6. Influence of Anglo-Norman in Ireland 7. See also 8. Notes 9. References 10. Bibliography 11. External links. Use and development. The literature of the Anglo-Norman period forms the reference point for subsequent literature in the Norman language, especially in the 19th century Norman literary revival and even into the 20th century in the case of André Dupont's Épopée Cotentine. The languages and literatures of the Channel Islands are sometimes referred to as Anglo-Norman, but that usage, derived from the French Isles Anglo-Normands, is wrong. The Channel Islanders spoke and still speak a variety of Norman, not Anglo-Norman. Anglo-Norman was never the main administrative language of England. Latin was the major language of record in legal and other official documents for most of the medieval period. However, from the late 12th century to the early 15th century, Anglo-Norman French and Anglo-French were much used in law reports, charters, ordinances, official correspondence, and trade at all levels. They were the language of the king, his court and the upper class. There is evidence, too, that foreign words Latin, Greek, Italian, Arabic, Spanish often entered English via Anglo-Norman. The language of later documents adopted some of the changes ongoing in continental French and lost many of its original dialectal characteristics, so Anglo-French remained in at least some respects and at least at some social levels part of the dialect continuum of modern French, often with distinctive spellings over time. The use of Anglo-French expanded into the fields of law, administration, commerce, and science, in all of which a rich documentary legacy survives, indicative of the vitality and importance of the language by the late 15th century. However, what remained of insular French had become heavily anglicized. See Law French. It continued to be known as Norman French until the end of the 19th century, even though, philologically, there was nothing Norman about it. One notable survival of influence on the political system is the use of certain Anglo-French set phrases in the Parliament of the United Kingdom for some endorsements to bills and the granting of royal assent to legislation. These set phrases include, Sois Bailey aux communes, let it be sent to the Commons, on a bill sent by the House of Lords to the House of Commons, Asseste bile avec un amendement, avec des amendements les communes sont assentes, to this bill with an amendment, with amendments the Commons have assented, on a bill passed by the House of Commons and returned to the House of Lords a set amendement, ces amendements les seigneurs sont assentes, to this amendment, these amendments the Lords have assented, on an amended bill returned by the House of Commons to the House of Lords, where the amendments were accepted, ceste bile est remise aux communes avec une raison, des raisons, this bill is returned to the Commons with a reason, with reasons, when the House of Lords disagrees with amendments made by the House of Commons, le roi, la reine le veut, the king, queen wills it, royal assent for a public bill, le roi, la reine remercie ses bons sujets, accepte leur benevolence et ainsi le veut, the king, queen thanks his, her good subjects, accepts their bounty, and wills it so, royal assent for a supply bill. Soit fait comme il est désiré, let it be done as it is desired, royal assent for a private bill, le roi, la reine se vacira, the king, queen will consider it. If royal assent is withheld, the exact spelling of these phrases has varied over the years, for example, se vacira has been spelled as sevisira and sedvisera, and reign is reign. Among important writers of the Anglo-Norman Cultural Commonwealth is Marie de France. Trilingualism in medieval England. Much of the earliest recorded French is in fact Anglo-Norman French in northern France. Almost nothing was at that time being recorded in the vernacular because Latin was the language of the nobility, education, and the Roman Catholic Church, and was thus used for the purpose of records. Latin did not disappear in medieval England either. It was used by the church, the royal government, and much local administration, as it had been before 1066. In parallel with Anglo-Saxon, the early adoption of Anglo-Norman as a written and literary language probably owes something to this history of bilingualism in writing around the same time, as a shift took place in France towards using Parisian French as a language of record in the mid-13th century. Anglo-Norman French also became a language of record in England, though Latin retained its pre-eminence for matters of permanent record from around this point onwards. Considerable variation begins to be apparent in Anglo-French, which ranges from the very local and most anglicized to a level of language which approximates to and is sometimes indistinguishable from varieties of continental French. Thus, typically, local records are rather different from continental French, with diplomatic and international trade documents closest to the emerging continental norm. English remained the vernacular of the common people throughout this period. Language of the king and his court. French was the language of the king and his court until the end of the 14th century. During this period, marriages with French princesses reinforced the French status in the royal family. Nevertheless, during the 13th century, intermarriages with English people became more frequent. French became progressively a second language among the upper classes. Moreover, with the Hundred Years' War and the growing spirit of English nationalism, the status of French diminished. French was the mother tongue of the English king until Henry IV 1399-1413. He was the first to take the oath in English, and his son, Henry V 1413-1422, was the first to write in English. By the end of the 15th century, French became the second language of a cultivated elite. Language of the royal charters and legislation. From the conquest 1066 until the end of the 13th century, Latin was the language of all official written documents, and Norman French was almost exclusively used as a spoken language. Nevertheless, some important documents had their official Norman translation, such as the Magna Carta signed in 1215. The first official document written in Anglo-Norman was a statute promulgated by the king in 1275. Thus, from the 13th century, Anglo-Norman became used in official documents, such as those that were marked by the private seal of the king, whereas the documents sealed by the Lord Chancellor were written in Latin until the end of the Middle Ages. English became the language of Parliament and of legislation in the 15th century, half a century after it had become the language of the king and of most of the English upper classes. Language of administration and justice. During the 12th century, development of the administrative and judicial institutions took place because the king and the lawyers at the time normally used Norman French. It also became the language of these institutions in the royal and local courts. From the 12th century until the 15th century, the courts used three languages. Latin was used for writing, Norman French was the main oral language during trials, and English was used in Less formal exchanges between the judge, the lawyer, the complainant or the witnesses. The judge gave his sentence orally in Norman, which was then written in Latin. Only in the lowest level of the manorial courts were trials entirely in English during the 15th century. English became the main spoken language, but Latin and French continued to be exclusively used in official legal documents until the beginning of the 18th century. Nevertheless, the Norman language used in England changed from the end of the 15th century into La French. This variety of French was a technical language, with a specific vocabulary, where English words were used to describe everyday experience, and French grammatical rules and morphology gradually declined, with confusion of genders and the adding of s to form all plurals. La French was banished from the courts of the common law in 1731, almost three centuries after the king ceased speaking primarily French language of the people, though the great mass of ordinary people spoke Middle English. French, because of its prestigious status, spread as a second language, encouraged by its long-standing use in the school system as a medium of instruction through which Latin was taught in the courts. The members of the jury, who represented the population, had to know French in order to understand the plea of the lawyer. French was used by the merchant middle class as a language of business communication, especially when it traded with the continent, and several churches used French to communicate with lay people. A small but important number of documents survive associated with the Jews of medieval England, some featuring Anglo-Norman written in Hebrew script, typically in the form of glosses to the Hebrew scriptures. Characteristics as a long doïl, Anglo-Norman developed collaterally to the central Gallo-Romance dialects, which would eventually become Parisian French in terms of grammar, pronunciation and vocabulary, before the signature of the Ordinance of Villers-Cotterêts in 1539 and long afterward in practice. French was not standardized as an official administrative language of the Kingdom of France. Middle English was heavily influenced by Anglo-Norman and, later, Anglo-French. W. Rothwell has called Anglo-French the missing link because many etymological dictionaries seem to ignore the contribution of that language in English, and because Anglo-Norman and Anglo-French can explain the transmission of words from French into English and fill the void left by the absence of documentary records of English in the main between 1066 and c. 1380. Anglo-Norman morphology and pronunciation can be deduced from its heritage in English. Mostly, it is done in comparison with continental Central French. English has many doublets as a result of this contrast. Warranty, guarantee. Warden, guardian. Catch, chase. See below. Compare also, wage. Anglo-Norman, gauge. French, weight. Guter, French. Old French. Guidier, war. From Anglo-Norman, where. Guerre, French. Wicket. Anglo-Norman, guichet. French. From Norman, the palatalization of velar consonants before the front vowel produced different results in Norman to the central long doïl dialects that developed into French English. Therefore, for example, has fashion from Norman fashion as opposed to modern French facon, both developing from Latin factio, factionum, the palatalization of velar consonants before. A. That affected the development of French did not occur in Norman dialects north of the Jurett line. English has therefore inherited words that retain a velar plosive where French has a fricative, English. From Latin that was not retained in French. However, Anglo-Norman also acted as a conduit for French words to enter England. For example, challenge clearly displays a form of French origin, rather than the Norman calenge. There were also vowel differences. Compare Anglo-Norman profound with Parisian French profond, sound with sun, round with ronde. The former words were originally pronounced something like profound, sound, ronde, respectively. Compare the similarly denasalized vowels of modern Norman, but later developed their modern pronunciation in English, since many words established in Anglo-Norman from French via the intermediary of Norman were not subject to the processes of sound change that continued in parts of the continent. English sometimes preserves earlier pronunciations. For example, ch used to be t in medieval French. Modern French has, but English has preserved the older sound in words like chamber, chain, chase and exchequer. Similarly, j had an older d sound, which it still has in English and some dialects of modern Norman, but it has developed into. In modern French, the word veil retains the a, as does modern Norman in veil and lycée, that in French has been replaced by w, voile. Loisir, the word mushroom, preserves a hush sibilant in mousseron not recorded in French orthography, as does cushion for cousin. Conversely, the pronunciation of the word sugar resembles Norman. Chucker. Even if the spelling is closer to French sucre, it is possible that the original sound was an apical sibilant, like the Basque S, which is halfway between a hissing sibilant and a hushing sibilant. The doublets catch and chase, both derived from Low Latin captiare catch, demonstrate a Norman development, while chase is the French equivalent imported with a different meaning. Distinctions in meaning between Anglo-Norman and French have led to many faux amis words having similar form but different meanings in modern English and modern French, since although a Romance language, Norman contains a significant amount of lexical material from Norse. Some of the words introduced into England as part of Anglo-Norman were of Germanic origin. Indeed, sometimes one can identify cognates such as Flock Germanic in English existing prior to the conquest and Floque Germanic in Norman. The case of the word mug demonstrates that in instances, Anglo-Norman may have reinforced certain Scandinavian elements already present in English. Mug had been introduced into Northern English dialects by Viking settlement. The same word had been established in Normandy by the Normans Norsemen and was then brought over after the conquest and established firstly in Southern English dialects. It is, therefore, argued that the word mug in English shows some of the complicated Germanic heritage of Anglo-Norman. Many expressions used in English today have their origin in Anglo-Norman, such as the expression beforehand derives from Anglo-Norman avant main, as do many modern words with interesting etymologies. Mortgage, for example, literally meant death wage in Anglo-Norman. Curfew fr couvre feu meant cover fire, referring to the time in the evening when all fires had to be covered. The word glamour is derived from Anglo-Norman gramier, the same word which gives us modern grammar. Glamour meant first book learning and then the most glamorous form of book learning. Magic or magic spell in medieval times. The influence of Anglo-Norman was very asymmetric. Very little influence from English was carried over into the continental possessions of the Anglo-Norman kings. Some administrative terms survived in some parts of mainland Normandy. Forlong from furrow, compare furlong in the Cotentin Peninsula and Besson, and a general use of the word acre for land measurement in Normandy until metrication in the 19th century, but these words are probably linguistic traces of Saxon or Anglo-Scandinavian settlements between the 4th and the 10th centuries in Normandy. Otherwise, the direct influence of English in mainland Norman, such as smuggler, to smuggle, is from direct contact in later centuries with English, rather than Anglo-Norman literature. See also, Anglo-Norman literature. When the Normans invaded England, Anglo-Saxon literature had reached a very high level of development. The important Benedictine monasteries both wrote chronicles and guarded other works. In Old English, however, with the arrival of the Norman, Anglo-Saxon literature came to an end and literature written in Britain was in Latin or Anglo-Norman. The Plantagenet kings encouraged this Anglo-Norman literature nevertheless. From the beginning of the 14th century, some authors chose to write in English, but it is only during the late 14th century that English literature was at its best. With Geoffrey Chaucer, the authors of that period were influenced by the works of contemporary French writers whose language was prestigious. Chaucer is considered to be the father of the English language and the creator of English as a literary language. Influence of Anglo-Norman French on English. About 28% of English vocabulary comes from French, including Anglo-French Green. The major Norman French influence on English can still be seen in today's vocabulary. An enormous number of Norman French loanwords came into the language, and about three-quarters of them are still used today. Very often, the Norman French word supplanted the Anglo-Saxon term, or both words would co-exist but with slightly different nuances. For example, ox describing the animal and beef describing the meat. In other cases, the Norman French word was adopted to signify a new reality, such as judge, castle, warranty. In general, the Norman French borrowings concerned the fields of culture, aristocratic life, politics and religion, and war, whereas the English words were used to describe everyday experience. When the Normans arrived in England, their copyists wrote English as they heard it. Without realizing the peculiarities of the relationship between Anglo-Saxon pronunciation and spelling, and so the spelling changed, there appeared different regional modern English written dialects, the one that the king chose in the 15th century becoming the standard variety in some remote areas. Agricultural terms used by the rural workers may have been derived from Norman French. An example is the Cumbrian term sturdy for diseased sheep that walk in circles, derived from etordi meaning giddy. Influence of Anglo-Norman in Ireland. The Norman invasion of Ireland took place in the late 12th century and led to Anglo-Norman control of much of the island. Norman-speaking administrators arrived to rule over the Angevin Empire's new territory. Several Norman words became Irish words, including household terms, garson from Norman garkin, boy, coda coat, cloak, hata hattie, hat, gerdan garden, garden, and terms relating to justice. Irish juistice, Bardas Corporation, Quirt court place names in Norman are few, but there is Buttevant from the motto of the Barry family, Butte en Avant, push to the fore, the village of Brittas from the Norman Bretesh, boarding, planking, and the element Palace Irish Palis, from Norman Police, boundary fence, cf Palisade. The Pale others exist with English or Irish roots, such as Castletown Roche, which combines the English Castletown and the Norman Roche, meaning rock. Only a handful of Hiberno-Norman French texts survive, most notably the Chanson de Geste. The Song of Dermot and the Earl early 13th century and the Statutes of Kilkenny 1366. See also Anglo-Norman Literature, Anglo-Norman Text Society Law, French Notes. Carrot, Hammerstrom, Harold, Forkel, Robert, Haspelmath, Martin, Bank, Sebastian, eds 2016, Anglo-Norman, Glottolog 27, Jena, Max Planck Institute for the Science of Human History. Retrieved 18 November 2007. Anglo-Norman Dictionary, online version, www.anglo-norman.an edition revisée 2005, OZ de la première edition, avec 78 textes numérisés, et une douzaine d'articles scientifiques surtout par W. Rothwell. Anglo-Norman Dictionary Fascicles I 1977, E 1981, E 1983, IV 1985, V 1988, V 1990, V 1992, London, MHRA ed W. Rothwell et all disponible, http://wowanglo-normanet/brand, Paul 1999, The Languages of the Law in Later Medieval England, Introtter 2000 A Brand, Paul 2010, The Language of the English Legal Profession, The Emergence of a Distinctive Legal Lexicon in Insular French, in Ingham 2010, 94-101 Brun, Laurent 2004, C.R. de Ruel 1999, ZRP 120, 190-194 Burgess, Glynn South 1995, Francisish Scriptiformen IV England Les Scriptae Francaises IV Angleterre in HOLTUS, Gunter, METZELTIN, Michael, Schmidt, Christian eds, Lexicon der Romanistischen Linguistik II, 2 Tübingen, 337-346 Butterfield, Artis 2009 The Familiar Enemy Chaucer, Language and Nation in the Hundred Years War Oxford, Oxford University Press CERQUIGLINI, Bernard 1991, La Naissance du Français, Paris, Presses Universitaires de France CERQUIGLINI, Bernard 2007, Une langue orpheline, Paris, Editions de Minuit. CHAPLAIS, Pierre 1975-1982 English Medieval Diplomatic Practice London, HMSOCLANCHY, MT 1993, From Memory to Written Record, England 1066-1307 2nd EDN Oxford Colas, JP 1964 ed. Year Books of Edward II, Volume XXV, London, Problems of Language and Interpretation, 14-127 Da, Rold, Orietta 2006, English Manuscripts 1060-1220 and the Making of a Resource. In Literature Compass 3, 750-766, N line, http://onlinelibrarywiley.com/doi.101111, J1741411320060034-4X, Consulte la 14 Mai 2013 de Young, Thera 1988, L'Anglo-Norman du 13 e siècle, in Van Rienen, p. 87-117 Dies, Anthonige 1987, Atlas des formes linguistiques des textes littéraires de l'ancien français Beheft zur ZRP, Vol. 212, Tübingen, Niemeyer Desi Schmid, Sarah, Hafner, Jochend, Heinemann, Sabine 2011 ed., Koinezerung und Standardizerung in der Romania, Heidelberg, Winter DMLBS equals Latham, Ronald E., David Howlett, and Richard Ashdown, Dictionary of Medieval Latin from British Sources Oxford, British Academy 1975 Dodd, Gwillem 2007 Justice and Grace, Private Petitioning and the English Parliament in the Late Middle Ages Oxford, Oxford University Press Durkin, Philip 2012 Etymological Research on English Words as a Source of Information about Anglo-French. In Present and Future Research in Anglo-Norman, Proceedings of the Aberystwyth Colloquium, 21-22 July 2011, ed. David Trotter, 101-107 Aberystwyth, Anglo-Norman Online Hub Duval, Frederick 2009, Le Français Médiéval Atelier du Médiéviste, 11 Turnhout, Breples Georgie, David 2008 Language Made Visible, The Invention of French in England After the Norman Conquest PhD Dis, New York State University, UMI No. 3,000,000 1,307,998 GERVERS, Michael, Marilise, Brian 1979, A 12th Century Hospitaller Charter in Anglo-Norman, Journal of the Society of Archivists 6, 131-35 GLESSGEN, Martin Dietrich 2012, Trajectoires et Perspectives en Scriptologie Romane, Medioevo Romanzo 36, 5-23 GOEBL, Hans 1970, Die Normandische Erkundensprache ein Betrag zur Kenntnis der Nordfranzosischen Erkundensprechen des Mittelalters Sitzungsbericht der Österreichischen Akademie der Wissenschaften, Phil Hist Class, 269 Vienne, Bolau GOEBL, Hans 1998, Zu einer dialektometrischen Analyse der Daten des Dieses Lasses von 1980, in, Werner, Edeltrode al ed, et multum et multa Festschrift für Peter Wunderlich zum 60 Geburtstag, Tübingen, NARR, 293-309 GOEBL, Hans 2008, Sur le changement macrolinguistique survenu entre 1300 et 1900 dans le domaine doïl une étude diachronique d'inspiration dialectometrique. Matrix, Dialectologia 1, 3-43, Disponible en Lignia l'adresse suivante, http://upublications/revistes/dialectologia1/consulte-la-02-0214, Gossin, Charles Théodore 1968a, Grapheme et phoneme, Le probleme central de l'étude des langues écrites au Moyen Âge, RLIR 32, 1-16, Gossin, Charles Théodore 1968b, L'interprétation des graphemes et la phonétique historique de la langue française, Trelili 6, I 1968, 149-168. Gossin, Charles Théodore 1979, Meditations Scriptologiques, CCM 22, 263-283 GOYENS, Michel, Verbeck, Werner 2003 ed., The Dawn of the Written Vernacular in Western Europe, Leuven, Leuven University Press Grubble, Klaus 2013, La Standardisation du Français au Moyen Âge, Point de Vue Scriptologique, RLIR 77, 344-383 Henry, Albert 1986, Un texte œnologique de Geoffroy de Waterford et Survey Copale, Romania 107, 1-37, Premier Publication, Item, Contribution à l'étude du langage œnologique en langue doïl, Bruxelles, Académie Royale de Belgique, I, 45-53 et 2, 37-49, Howlett, David 1996, The English Origins of Old French Literature, Dublin, Four Courts Press Hunt, Tony 2000, Code Switching in Medical Texts in Trotter 2000 A Hunt, Tony 2003, Anglo-Norman, Past and Future. In the Dawn of the Written Vernacular in Western Europe, Ed Michel Goyens and Werner Verbeck, 379-389 Leuven, Leuven University Press Ingham, Richard 2012, The Transmission of Anglo-Norman, Language History and Language Acquisition, Amsterdam, Benjamins Ingham, Richard, Mixing Languages on the Manor, Medium Avum 78-2009, 80-97 equals 2009 Ingham, Richard, Syntactic Change in Anglo-Norman and Continental French Chronicles. Was there a Middle Anglo-Norman, Journal of French Language Studies 16-2006, 26-49 Ingham, Richard, The Status of French in Medieval England, Evidence from the Use of Object Pronoun Syntax, Vox Romanica 65-2006, 1-22 Jefferson, Lisa 2000, The Language and Vocabulary of the 14th and Early 15th Century Records of the Goldsmiths Company, in Trotter 2000 A, 175-211 Jefferson, Lisa and Rothwell, William 1997, Society and Lexis, A Study of the Anglo-French Vocabulary in the 15th Century Accounts of the Merchants Tailors Company Zeitschrift für Französische Sprache und Literatur, 107, 273-301 KABATEK, Johannes 2013, Coines and Scriptae, in, Maiden, Martin, Smith, John Charles, Ledgeway, Adam Ed, Cambridge History of the Romance Languages, 2, Contexts, Cambridge, Cambridge University Press, 143-186 Koch, Peter Chapter 2010, Sprachgeschichte zwischen Nahe und Distanz, Latin, Französisch Deutsch, in, Egel, Vilmosch, Hennig, Matilda ed., Nahe und Distanz im Kontext Variationslinguistischer Forschung, Berlin, New York, De Gruyter, 155-205 Kowaleski, Marianne 2007, Alien, Encounters in the Maritime World of Medieval England Medieval Encounters 13-96-121 Kowaleski, Marianne 2009, The French of England, A Maritime Lingua Franca. In Wogan Brown 2009-103-117 Crystal, Andres 1989, Le Débit du Rayonnement Parisien et l'Unité du Français au Moyen Âge, Le Témoignage des Manuels d'Enseignement du Français Publiés en Angleterre entre la Chie et le Débit du XVIe siècle, RLIR 53, 335-367 Crystal, Andres 1990, L'Enseignement du Français en Angleterre chez XVIe siècles, Les Sources Manuscrites, Romania, 111, 298-330 Crystal, Andres 2000, L'Intellectuel, Anglo-Norman, Face à la pluralité des langues, Le témoignage implicité du Ms. Oxford, Magdalen Lot 188, Intrater 2000A, 37-52, Leg, Dominica 1965, La précocité de la littérature anglo-normande, CCM 8, 327-349 Lodge, Anthony R. 2004, A sociolinguistic history of Parisian French, Cambridge, Cambridge University Press Lodge, Anthony R. 2010A, The Sources of Standardization in French, Written or Spoken, in, Ingham 2010, 26-43 Lodge, Anthony R. 2010B, Standardization, Coineization et l'Historiographie du Français, RLIR 74, 5-26 Lodge, Anthony R. 2011, Standardization et Coineization, Der Approaches Contraires à l'Historiographie d'une Langue, in, Desi Schmid, Hafner, Heinemann 2011, 65-79. Lusignan, Serge 1986, Parler vulgairement les intellectuels et la langue française aux chies et xive siècles Paris, Montreal Lusignan, Serge 2004, La langue des rois au Moyen Âge, Le français en France et en Angleterre, Paris, Presses universitaires de France Lusignan, Serge 2005 La langue des rois au Moyen Âge Paris, Puflusignan, Serge 2011, Le français médiéval, Perspectives historiques sur une langue plurielle, in, Lusignan, Serge, Martineau, France, Morin, Yves-Charles, Cohen, Paul, L'introuvable unité du français contacts et variations linguistiques en Europe et en Amérique xiii xv siècle, Laval, Presses de l'Université Laval, 5-107, Maitland, F.W., 1903, Year Books of Edward II, Volume 1, 1. Anglo-Normand de l'Agriculture, 14 Congresso Internazionale di Linguistica e Filologia Romanza, Adi, T4, Napoli Gaetano Macchiaroli, ed., Amsterdam, 143-157 Morin, Frankwilt 1981, AGN Affer, Aver eine Wortgeschichtliche und Wissenschaftsgeschichtliche Untersuchung, Archive für das Studium der Neueren Sprechen und Literaturen 218129-136 Morin, Frank 1986, Wort und Sachgeschichtliche Untersuchungen in Französischen Landwirtschaftlichen Texten, 13, 14 und 18 Jahrhundert Seneschoshi, Menagier, Encyclopédie, Tübingen Niemeyer Morin, Frankwilt 1997, Unité et Diversité du Champ Semasiologique, L'Exemple de l'Anglo-Norman Dictionary, in Gregory, Stuart and Trotter, David E.D.S., De Mo and Mo, Essays in Honor of William Rothwell, Cardiff, 127-146 Morin, Frankwilt 2000, One-Fold Lexicography for a Manifold Problem, in Trotter 2000A, 157-168 Morin, Frankwilt 2007, Dictionnaire étymologique de l'ancien français, Complément bibliographique 2007, Tübingen, Niemeyer Molinelli, Piera, Guarini, Federica 2013 ed., Plurilinguismo e diglossia nella tarda antichita et nel medio evo traditio et renovatio, 7, Firenze, Sismel, Edizioni del Galluzzo. Monfrin, Jacques 1968, La mode de tradition des actes écrits et les études de dialectologie, RLIR 32, 17-47 NCA equals Stein, Akim, Kunstmann, Pierre, Gliegen, Martin D. ed. 2010, Nouveau Corpus d'Amsterdam Corpus informatique de textes littéraires d'ancien français ca 1150-1350, Etable par Anthonige des Amsterdam 1987, Institut fur linguistique, romanistique, version 2 Disponible en ligne à l'adresse suivante, http://uni-stuttgart/lingram/stein/corpus/hash-nc-nielsen, Hans Fried and Schossler, Lena eds 1996, The Origins and Development of Emigrant Languages Proceedings from the Second Rasmus Rask Colloquium, Odense University, November 1994, Odense Pepin, Guilhem 2009 Petitions from Gascony Testimonies of a Special Relationship. In Medieval Petitions Grace and Grievance, ed. W. Mark Ormrod, Gwillem Dodd, ed. Anthony Musson, 120-134 York, York Medieval Press, Boydell Press Pfister, Max 1973, Die Sprachliche Bedeutung von Paris und der Ile de France vor dem 13. Jahrhundert, Vox Romanica 32, 217-253 Pfister, Max 1993, Scripta et Coin en Ancien Francais aux XIIe et XI siècles, in Necht, Pierre, Marzys, Zygmunt ed., Écriture, Langues communes et normes formation spontanée de coins et standardisation dans la Gallo-Romania et son voisinage, Genève, Neuchâtel, Droz, Faculté des Lettres, 17-41. Pfister, Max 1999, Larea Galloromanza, in, Boitani, Piero, Mancini, Mario, Varvaro, Alberto ed., Lo spazio letterario del Medioevo, tu il Medioevo volgar, I la produzione del testo, Rome, Salerno, 18-96 Pope, Mildred K. 21952, From Latin to Modern French, with a special consideration of Anglo-Norman, Manchester, Manchester University Press Posels, Dave 1995, Noms de Persons en langue française dans l'Angleterre du Moyen Âge, Le Moyen Âge, 101, 7-21 Richardson, Helen 1940, A 12th-century Anglo-Norman Charter, Bulletin of the John Rylands University Library, 24, 168-172 Richter, Michael 1979, Sprache und Gesellschaft im Mittelalter, Untersuchungen zur mündlichen Kommunikation in England von der Mitte des 11 bis zum Beginn des 14 Jahrhunderts Stuttgart Robson, Charles Allen 1955, Literary Language, Spoken Dialect, and the Phonological Problem of Old French, Transactions of the Philological Society 1955, 117-180 Roques, Giles 1997, Des Interférences Picards dans l'Anglo-Norman Dictionary. In De Mo and Mo, Essays in Honor of William Rothwell, Ed Stuart Gregory and D.A. Trotter, 191-198 Cardiff, MHRA, University of Wales Press Roques, Giles 2007 Les Régionalismes dans quelques textes Anglo-Normans. In Acts. Du XXIVE Congrès International de Linguistique et de Philologie Romaine, ed. David Trotter, 4, 279-292 Tübingen, Niemeyer Rothwell, William 1968, The Teaching of French in Medieval England, Modern Language Review, 63, 37-46 Rothwell, William 1973, O en sont les études d'Anglo-Normand, Zeitschrift für Französische Sprache und Literatur, 83, 195-204 Rothwell, William 1976a, Medical and Botanical Terminology from Anglo-Nonan Sources, Zeitschrift für Französische Sprache und Literatur, 86, 221-60 Rothwell, William 1976b, The Role of French in 13th-Century England, Bulletin of the John Rylands University Library of Manchester, 58, 445-66 Rothwell, William 1978, A quelle époque a-t-on cessé de parler français en Angleterre in Mélanges de Philologie Romane Offerts D. Charles Camprou Montpelier, Centre d'Estudies Occitans, 1075-89 Rothwell, William 1979, Anglo-French Lexical Contacts, Old and New, Modern Language Review, 74, 287-96 Rothwell, William 1980, Lexical Borrowing in a Medieval Context, Bulletin of the John Rylands University Library of Manchester, 63, 118-43 Rothwell, William 1983, Language and Government in Medieval England, Zeitschrift für Französische Sprache und Literatur, 93. 258-70 Rothwell, William 1985a, From Latin to Modern French, 50 Years On, Bulletin of the John Ryans University Library of Manchester, 68, 179-209 Rothwell, William 1985b, Stratford at Bowie and Paris's, Modern Language Review, 80, 39-54 Rothwell, William 1991, The Missing Link in English Etymology, Anglo-French, Medium Avum, 60, 173-90 96 Rothwell, William 1992, Chaucer and Stratford at Bowie, Bulletin of the John Rylands University Library of Manchester, 74, 3-28 Rothwell, William 1993a, The Legacy of Anglo-French, Faux Amos in French and English, Zeitschrift für Romanische Philologie, 109-16-46 Rothwell, William 1993b, The Fausse Francis d'Angleterre, Later Anglo-Norman, in short, Ian ed. Anglo-Norman Anniversary Essays, London, 309-326 Rothwell, William 1993 c. From Latin to Anglo-French and Middle English, The Role of the Multilingual Gloss, Modern Language Review, 88, 581-99 Rothwell, William 1994, The Trilingual England of Geoffrey Chaucer, Studies in the Age of Chaucer, 16, 45-67 Rothwell, William 1996a, Adding Insult to Injury, The English Who Curse in Borrowed French, in Nielsen, Chaucer 1996, 41-54. Rothwell, William 1996b, Playing Follow My Leader in Anglo-Norman Studies, Journal of French Language Studies, 6, 177-210 Rothwell, William 1996c, The Anglo-French Element in the Vulgar Register of Late Middle English, Neufilologische Mitteilungen, 97, 423-36 Rothwell, William 1999, Sugar and Spice and All Things Nice, From Oriental Bazaar to English Cloister in Anglo-French, Modern Language Review Review 94, 647-659 Rothwell, William 1999b, Aspects of Lexical and Morphosyntactical Mixing in the Languages of Medieval England in Trotter 2000a Rothwell, William 2000, The Trial Scene in Lanville and the Development of the Legal Register in Anglo-Norman, Neufilologische Mitteilungen 101, 17-36 Rothwell, William 2001a, Stratford at Bowie Revisited, Chaucer Review 36, 184-207 Rothwell, William 2001b, English and French in England after 1362, English Studies 82, 539-559 Rothwell, William 2001c, Arrivals and Departures, The Adoption of French Terminology into Middle English, in English Studies, 144-165 Rothwell, William 2001d, OED, Med., and, The Making of a New Dictionary of English, Anglia, Zeitschrift für English Philologie 119, 527-553. Rothwell, William 2002, The Semantic Field of Old French Astille, The Pitfalls of the Medieval Gloss in Lexicography, Journal of French Language Studies 12, 203-220 Rothwell, William 2004, Henry of Lancaster and Geoffrey Chaucer, Anglo-French and Middle English in 14th-century England, Modern Language Review 99, 313-27 Rothwell, William 2005b, The Problem of the English Dribble, Drivel, Drizzle and Trickle, The Role of Semantics in Etymology, Anglia, Zeitschrift für English Philologie 123, 191-203 Rothwell, William 2006, Anglo-French and English Society in Chaucer's The Reeve's Tale, English Studies, A Journal of English Language and Literature 87, 511-38 Rothwell, William 2007, Synonymity and Semantic Variability in Medieval French and Middle English, Modern Language Review 102-22, 363-80 Rothwell, William 2008, Anglo-French in Rural England in the Later 13th Century, Walter of Bibesworth's Treatise and the Agricultural Treatises, Vox Romanica 67, 100-132 Rothwell, William, Anglo-French and the An, http://www.wawanglo-normanet/sitedocs/main-intro-html/sec1ruel, Pierre 1999, Recueil General des Isopets tome quatrième, Les Fables du de Sheridan, Paris, Société des Anciens Textes Français. Schauwecker, Jelle 2007, Die Diätetik nach dem Secretum Secretorum in der Version von Geoffroy de Waterford Teiledition und Lexikalische Analyse, Würzburg, Königshausen. Short, Ian 1992, Patrons and Polyglots, French Literature in 12th-Century England, Anglo-Norman Studies 14, 327-349 Short, Ian 1995, Tam Angli Quam Franci, Self-Definition in Anglo-Norman England, Anglo-Norman Studies XVIII, 153-175 Short, Ian 2007, Manual of Anglo-Norman Ants, Occasional Publication Series, 7, London, Anglo-Norman Text Society Stanovaya, Lydia 2003, La Standardisation en Ancien Français, in, Goyens, Verbeek 2003, 241-272 Studer, Paul 1920 The Study of Anglo-Norman, Inaugural Lecture Delivered Before the University of Oxford on 6 February 1920 Oxford, Clarendon Press. Trotter, David 1997, Massenhor, Fet Meter Equesta Lettre en Bonne Française, Anglo-French in Gascony, in Gregory, Stewart and Trotter, David eds, De Mo en Mo, Essays in Honor of William Rothwell, Cardiff, 199-222. Trotter, David 1998b, Les Néologismes de l'Anglo-Français et le Feu, Le Moyen Français 39-41, 577-636. Trotter, David 1998c, Some Lexical Gleanings from Anglo-French Gascony, Zeitschrift für Romanische Philologie 114, 53-72. Trotter, David 1998d, Translations and Loanwords, Some Anglo-Norman Evidence, in Ellis, R, Tixier, R and Weitmeier, Beds, The Medieval Translator 6, Proceedings of the International Conference of Göttingen 22-25 July 1996, Louvain-la-Neuve, 20-39. Trotter, David 2000a, Multilingualism in Later Medieval Britain, Proceedings of the 1997 Aberystwyth Colloquium, Cambridge. Trotter, David 2000b, L'Avenir de la Lexicographie Anglo-Normande, Vers une refonte de l'Anglo-Norman Dictionary, Review de Linguistique Romane, 64 2000, 391-407. Trotter, David 2000c, Anglo-Norman, in Glanville Price ed., Languages of the British Isles Oxford, Blackwell, 197-206. Trotter, David 2003a, L'Anglo-Normand, Variété insulaire, O Variété isolée, Medievales, 45, 43-54. Trotter, David 2003b, The Anglo-French Lexis of the Ancrene Wiese, A Re-Evaluation, in a Companion to Ancrene Wiese, ed. Yoko Wada Cambridge, Boydell.